here on the Made It Music Podcast. Seth Mosley here with my friend Steve Robertson.
Hey now.
A&R at Atlantic Records. Worked with acts like Shinedown, Paramore, and A Day to Remember, as well as many more than that, which we'll get into. Thank you so much for being with us on the podcast.
Absolutely. I'm very stoked to be here.
And I have to say, I'm intimidated interviewing you because you have such a better voice for this than I do.
That's right, Seth.
Is that an acquired thing? Like no. Something you've worked on your whole life?
It just comes out that way. I was in radio before my job in A&R, and I'm from the Midwest, and I went to school for radio. And in lucky for me, when you go to broadcasting school, they teach you the first thing they teach you is to have a Midwest accent. Because
really?
Doing voiceover and being a DJ that moves around the country, they try to give you a middle of the road or middle America or Midwest accent. So I was one up on it.
And where did you grow up again?
Fort Wayne, Indiana, till I was 13.
So you kind of already had a little bit of a Midwest.
That's what
thing,
I'm saying.
Right?
That part was not a struggle. The people in there with Southern accents that I had to sort of straighten it out into this sort of straight, yeah. Boring.
Were there literally classes on dialect, yeah, and enunciation?
Yes.
And, wow. Yeah. Well, you naturally have, and we'll get off this. I'm just fascinated with people that have a voice like yours, because it seems like, to me, something that is a practiced thing.
No, when I go through, when I'm ordering at Wendy's or whatever,
yeah.
I'm like, yeah, I'll have a cheeseburger, and I've had, I'm like, are you on the radio? Are you on commercial? And I'm like, I'm not trying to sound.
This is just how you
talk.
It's
literally what I sound like.
I love it. Well, We'll dive into that. I want to go all the way back to the beginning. What was the moment that music impacted you for the first time and you knew you absolutely had to like make it your life?
I'm the youngest of six kids, Catholic, Midwest upbringing, and my older brothers and sisters, but my older brothers were all like huge music fans. So I would walk down into the basement and I would see my brother with headphones on, just lost. This is before I knew what that was, but he had, you know, cord plugged into the receiver and he had like Led Zeppelin gatefold album open on his lap and with his eyes closed and just lost in it. And so that was always a thing. You're like, that's weird when you're a little kid. And then it starts to make more sense. And then my oldest brother was a DJ at the rock station in Fort Wayne, Indiana, WMEE. It was, I think it's still there. It's not a rock station anymore. He became a DJ and I just thought that was the coolest thing. And then on the radio, the moment I felt music touch my soul as a kid, where it was an unidentifiable feeling. We've all had it. And it dates me a little bit because this song is actually older. It was an older song. It was already out for a while, but by the time I heard it when I was a kid, it came out in the 60s. It was the Turtles' Happy Together. I can't see me loving nobody but you.
Yeah.
Seth. All my life. Anyway. That I just, every time it came on the radio, I would stand in front of the speaker and just go, it almost made me lightheaded.
Wow.
Yeah, intoxicating.
Wow. So from that moment, what was the story that led you into, you know, your career at radio? That's phase one is radio, and then, you know, working at labels is phase two. What led up to phase one?
Phase one was my oldest brother being the DJ and then me saying, back then it was, if you're a DJ on the radio in a small to medium sized town, you're a celebrity.
Yeah.
So when my brother, who didn't live in the house anymore, when he came over to the house, all my friends were like, oh, Tom Maxwell, was his name back then? Tom, I forget what he was going by back then, but Tom from WME is at Steve's house.
Yeah.
And then we would,
is everybody like, hey, say something.
Say, yeah, it was like that.
Yeah.
And I just thought it was so cool hearing my brother on the radio playing records.
Yeah.
And I think I knew what I was going to do for a living by the time I was like 8 years old.
So how did you like get a job in that? Like what was the steps in that process?
It was the steps. One step was a non-step, which was I had no interest in going to university. I had no interest in going to college. I had no interest in taking more math and science. Even though I'm inquisitive and a smart person, I don't, that style of learning was was not for me. And the sooner I could be done with that, the better. But I wanted to be a successful career person. So we moved to Fort Lauderdale from Miami, and I went to high school in Fort Lauderdale. And there was a college there called Bowder College, which specifically taught broadcasting and prepped you for a career in radio.
Yeah. So went from that, got, you know, got hired, did the gigs and everything. What I love about your story in radio is that there were sort of hints of what you do now as an A&R person, even back then, with like finding, you know, new bands and playing, showcasing new talent. Can you talk a little bit about that? Maybe some, yeah, notable moments or stories from that time?
Yeah, the 90s was where it was at for me with that. I started in radio in the 80s down in Miami. I was at a classic rock station for 6 or 7 years. I was a DJ and just playing Led Zeppelin records all day. And which I love Led Zeppelin and I love Steely Dan and I love all that music. But during the mid 80s, I was getting, you know, I was watching MTV and getting turned on to everything from The Cure to Flock of Seagulls to Echo and the Bunny Men. And then I would go to work and be playing the same Led Zeppelin records every day. And I was really started to get into going to see bands. So and that's when the alternative rock format, like mid 80s, that's when I started hearing about K-Rock in LA and 91X in San Diego. And I actually went on a surf trip to California with my buddy, and I heard K-Rock for the first time. And again, this is pre-internet. Yeah. So the music you had, the way you were exposed to new music was a DJ on the radio. And when I heard K-Rock playing the Smiths or Morris, like, that I'm on from the East Coast of Florida specifically, nobody's doing that. Yeah. And I'm here, I am in a huge Los Angeles market listening to music that was just blowing my mind that I'd only heard about or a little bit of. And so that lit the fire. I was like, I want to program an alternative rock station. I just knew that's what I wanted to do. Long story short, I went to the program director, Neil Mirsky, great program director, legendary program director, who was programming Zeta 4 in Miami at the time, which was the classic rock station where I was working. I said, I want to be a program director. And he said, it's funny you would say that. We just bought a new station in Orlando, Florida, and we're going to make it a new kind of rock station. He didn't say alternative rock. He said a new kind of rock station. So I did the interviews, and they hired me as a assistant program director, music director of WJRR in Orlando, Florida. And that's where it started. And I had only one goal. They had no interest in making it an alternative rock station, because to them that meant no ratings. Yeah. And also they thought that meant it was like a college rock station that was just played eclectic music that nobody cared about. But I already had, this is 1991, 92 when we started talking about this. I already had Nirvana, Bleach, and I already had Smashing Pumpkins, Gish, and Live's first album. And I just instinctively felt through being a fan, this groundswell of alternative music that I felt could break through. And so my whole goal was to be a DJ and be a program director at a station like that.
Yeah. So even establishing that from the first place, I mean, that's sort of an act of A&R, right? You're seeing this talent that's out there, this amazing music that's being made, and you're like, why are we not showcasing this?
That's a very good point. That's exactly, I didn't know that at the time.
Yeah.
I knew I wanted to be a part of exposing that music.
So what were some of the, well, I had to imagine there was some bumps in the road, maybe getting people on board with that, as you said, maybe the station itself. Like, how did you achieve success doing that?
They hired me, and again, I kept talking about alternative rock. They didn't like that word. They just knew. They had this huge morning show. I won't go too far in depth, but there was a huge, like Howard Stern-esque morning show that was syndicated in Florida. They were called the Ron and Ron Show. And the whole station was built on this morning show that they were syndicating into Orlando. So they just said, let's make it a different kind of rock station. Let's not make it a classic rock station. Let's play current music. And that's all it was. Meanwhile, I'm like, there's a groundswell coming that you guys don't know about that that will be well beyond like college music or college rock. And so I just sort of selfishly was guiding the station because I had my hands on the controls of the programming to add the records that were, you know, I think when we put the station on the air, Stone Temple Pilots, Plush, one of the great songs of the 90s, was just getting going. And I remember the guy that was like the operations manager, they didn't know anything about this music. And they were looking at the charts about like what records we were making the station in real time. Like, okay, well, let's ask this young Steve-O kid what we should be playing. And they were like, well, what's this Stone Temple Pilots Plush? Because it was still climbing the chart. Yeah. I was like, oh my God.
They literally had no idea what it was.
They didn't know what it was. It was brand new. And wow. I just happened to be a huge Stone Temple Pilots fan because I love being early on that stuff. And it went from there. So it was a mess at first. We were playing like Eddie Money and Stone Temple Pilots and Led Zeppelin. And it just didn't, they were trying to, again, a new kind of rock station. Well, anyway, over a course of a year, the alternative format rose to prominence in the early to mid 90s. And I was able to sort of get my way and turn it into an alternative rock station.
Yeah. So in that process, I mean, you sort of happened upon some pretty amazing artists, whether or not, you know, you want to take credit for discovering them or not. I mean, just even the story of Collective Soul is pretty remarkable. Do you care to share a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, yeah.
And any others for that matter.
So when you're the program director of a rock station or of any radio station, and you're the music director, it's your job to obviously, and newsflash, DJs don't pick the music, and it's still disappointing to people, but they don't, or they rarely do pick their own records.
Yeah.
So there's a program director that does that, and it's by design, because then that way you get songs and programming that spread out evenly over the day. And it's in line with how people actually listen to the radio. So,
yeah. But thank you for clarifying that too, because there's a lot of people out there who maybe have no idea of that.
Yeah. I mean, DJs at college stations pick their and non-commercial stations, but if you're listening to a commercial station owned by a big company, that DJ is not picking those songs.
Yeah.
Maybe for a request show or something like that, they are. So, that was my job. It not only was my job to program the music through a computer program, but it was also to add the latest current records that you thought would be hits and would also add to the sound of your station and make it exciting. So that was the best part. That was the best. We'd have music meetings every Monday and listen to all the latest, and radio promotion or promotion people from the labels would come through, play their records, try to get you to add them. And that part of the job was fun, but we were also getting unsigned bands were sending their stuff to the station, and I was trying to listen to all that as well. And one day, and again, this is in the 90s, so we weren't getting links to SoundCloud, or MP3s, we were getting CDs. I'd stacks of CDs all over my desk, and I don't know why, but there was a CD sitting there, and it said Collective Soul. It had terrible artwork on it. And I was like, that is so ugly. I want to find out what that sounds like. So I put the CD in, and it was their full album. And I went through it, and I heard that famous riff from the song called Shine. I was like, that just sounds right for the music that we're playing. And then I asked the DJ, our afternoon guy, I was like, hey, man, can you just fit this in and see what happens? Again, the 90s, this is pre-Shazam. So when people got excited about something, they called the radio station and would be like, want to know what that was or what's on the air right now. This song's great. And when you would see that happen on the phones, we had 6 or 7 lines in there. When you would see that happen, you knew that you had something. And that's what happened with Collective Soul Shine.
Yeah.
And so I was like, then I, hey, play it again. I gave it to the next DJ for the next shift, play this and same thing. So we actually added an unsigned band, which I didn't realize how rare that was because I was still pretty new at the job. We added Collective Soul Shine. My boss, John Frost, at the time was like, I don't care if you think it sounds like a hit, play it. which I was like, great, this is fun. And it totally blew up in Orlando, and it started selling. The record, they got distribution in Orlando, and it started selling. And then Atlantic was really good at sniffing those things out. And so they came down. I remember Jason Flom came down to, we set up a showcase for Collective Soul.
Yeah, and maybe give a little context for people who don't know who Jason Flom is.
Legendary A&R guy, massively successful. Signed like Twisted Sister in the 80s and White Lion, and then he just, Jason Flom just has a knack for once every, I've never really averaged it out, I'd say every once every 5 to 7 years, stumbles on Kid Rock, Matchbox 20, Lord, most recently Greta Van Fleet.
Wow.
Listen, I'm okay at what I do, and I've been doing it for a long time. He's just on another level from most people that I know that do this job. So, but I didn't know that at the time. I just knew this guy named Jason Flom that was a big wig at Atlantic was coming down. Saw the show, signed Collective Soul, and Shine became a huge song shortly thereafter, like nationwide. And that's when people started saying to me, people from labels, promotion people, were like, oh, like once that song showed up, not just on my playlist, but on charts across the country, they're like, oh my God, that started in Orlando. You found that. You should do A&R. And I was like, that's awesome. What's A&R? And then you start reading books and start figuring out how the industry works and that they actually pay people to find new talent and try to make hits. And so I was like, I figured out, I bet if I do that again, I have a 100,000 watt radio station at my disposal and nobody else there knows the like they just let me add the records that I want, basically.
It's shocking to me how unscientific of a process that sounds like. not to take away from, because it really was your gut and your ears and your taste, I guess you could say, at the time. The things that you liked resonated with a large amount of people.
Yeah.
And we can, man, maybe we even kind of deep dive into that after the interview, because I think a lot of people are sort of fascinated with how that works and just how is radio different nowadays than it maybe was back then. Because that had to be a little bit of a rare thing, because it wasn't based on as much like ratings, maybe. Or feel free to correct me if I'm wrong there.
Ratings were everything, so they didn't want you to just add if you make your station too unfamiliar by adding too many records every week, that's a tune out for people. Like that, when you're a radio station playing current music, you have to balance it with familiar music. The challenge when I was doing it, we put an alternative rock station on in Florida in 1993. Everything was new. Like your baseline. Prior to that, if you started a rock station that played new music, your catalog was Led Zeppelin and Jimi Hendrix and Bad Company.
Yeah, so it was all new.
But in the 90s, it was like that stuff didn't belong, even though it's awesome. It was Pearl Jam and Soundgarden and with a smattering of the alternative bands that came before, like The Cure and The Smiths and things like that. But even that wasn't totally part of this new grunge thing that was happening. So, you know, we had a library of like 120 songs that were actual recent hits. Nirvana, Smells Like Teen Spirit, Pearl Jam, Alive and Black and Stone Temple Pilots and all that stuff. So that was your library, which only came out a few years ago. And then, so you want to keep it familiar and also exciting by adding the right records. But if I got overzealous and I definitely made the station unfamiliar early on, and the ratings went like,
oh, okay.
So I know what that feels like.
Sure.
So you have to restrain yourself from being, I love all these records, I need to play them all. You have to be really picky and choosy about what you do, because you'll screw up your radio station.
Okay. Well, I think you actually could just covered it really good. So we'll do the deep dive on something else. But okay. That was great. That was a really great way.
That was a pre-deep dive.
Pre-deep dive. Okay. We deep dived in the sidebar of the interview. Anyway, back to our discussion. So Collective Soul, Shine, were there other sequels after that kind of played out that way and sort of led into your A&R position?
Yeah, so I figured if I did it again, it was all about track record to prove that it wasn't a fluke. There was a band from Orlando called 7 Mary 3, and they sent their album. It was almost the identical story to Collective Soul. I listened to the album and I heard a song called Cumbersome, and I was like, that sounds like a hit.
Great song, yeah.
And let's play that. And the recording of it back then was not a great recording. But the song itself, people reacted to. The same thing happened. Atlantic came down, saw 7 Mary 3, signed him. A guy named Jay Ferris, who was running Mammoth Records at the time, which Atlantic had purchased. Anyway, they came down, signed 7 Mary 3, Cumbersome became a number one song. They sold 1 million records. And then that was sort of my track record, if you will.
Sure.
And at the time, I was also playing a band called Tabitha Secret that another DJ at another station had turned me on to, this guy named Surfer Dave that was a DJ at... He had an alternative show on Sunday nights on the pop station, because alternative rock was this new thing that ever, like, even the top 40 station had their own show, like, dedicated to playing new alternative rock. It was on Sunday nights. A lot of people didn't hear it, but it was there. And this guy, Surfer Dave, that was a DJ that did that show, I met him out one time, and he was like, man, have you heard Tabitha Secret? And then I heard that, and I was like, oh my God, that could be. And so I started playing this song called 3 AM. They became Matchbox 20. And so I don't take credit for the success of any of those bands, but I'm in there somewhere helping out.
Yeah, that's certainly a big, you know, if they would have a book with chapters, that has to certainly have a chapter there.
There's a chapter there.
And that's amazing. So again, that common thread of you sort of having been an A&R person, enjoying being on the front end of something that the masses had not yet discovered. And Atlantic obviously saw an immense amount of value in that, is amazing. And that expands into the fact of where we're at now. And we'll kind of, let's call phase two getting hired at Atlantic. And let's say phase three is you establishing the presence in Nashville and being on the front end of growing a genre of music, pop and rock, in Nashville that largely was in a music city that was country and singer-songwriter and Americana. So this is, I can see there's a common thread throughout your entire story. So let's unpack the second chapter of, like, how did you get hired? When did you get hired? What were some of the things that happened when you got hired at Atlantic?
I got hired in 97 or 98 by Atlantic. They flew me to New York first class, which I had never flown first class before. I'd barely ever flown before. I was like, oh, this is
great.
Big
deal.
Yeah, it was like a big deal.
Yeah.
And then did the interview. And the interesting part about this is the guy that was running Atlantic at the time, a guy named Val Azzoli, was like, well, Steve, man, we want you to work here. What do you want to do? And I, in the back of my mind, I was like thinking, I really don't want to move to New York, even though I totally would. Like, this is my dream job. I'll move wherever you want me to go. But I just, for some reason, blurted out, I don't know, man, I could stay in Florida and just find bands. And he was like, great. All right, great. I was like, really?
That was the whole conversation.
That was it. It was like, so I'll just work out of my house and listen to music and travel around and find bands and hope. And then he's like, yeah, I just want you to sign bands. He goes, you clearly got this thing. You got something.
Wow.
And there was no training. There was no anything. It was like, go sign bands. And come back when you have something. Yeah. Come back when you have something. So, and I already had a band that I wanted to sign, and just briefly, because this is part of the story.
Yeah.
I had a band that I was going to start playing on my radio station, but I got the job with Atlantic and they had a song called Live Through This. They were called Mighty Joe Plum and they were from Tampa, Florida. And I got the job before I could start playing on the radio. And I took it to the guy that was running A&R at the time. He's like, I like the song. I like the band. They've got nothing going on. They need to have something going on. So that's when I kind of became the manager of the band. And I knew all the radio programmers in Florida. And I was like, I'll make a radio story with this because I think this song is a hit. So I got this song, Live Through This by Mighty Joe Plum, added to, I don't know, all the rock stations in Florida, which... I was even proud of that, but it started reacting and the same kind of thing started to happen. And then we ended up signing the band because of that story. And then it didn't really happen.
Sure.
That taught me, because you start to go, well, geez, if I like it, then that means millions of people will like it.
Right.
And, exactly. But there's also different ways to screw that up. And yeah. You start learning that it's not quite so snap your fingers easy, especially when you don't have the benefit of controlling a 100,000 watt radio station.
Yeah. Well, and it's a different skill too, because you were curating songs before. I mean, you're obviously curating artists, but people were connecting with the song. It wasn't that if they loved a song didn't mean they would love this person.
Right.
So I feel like that's a huge element of A&R, is like you're going out and hanging out with these people just as much as listening to their music, right? Like,
yes, that's part of it. And I found out once you leave a radio station and go onto the label side, you no longer have the benefit. Like the records that I would get from unsigned bands at the radio station had been produced, obviously, and somebody else had done that work.
Yeah.
Then I realized, well, if I'm going to find artists before other people find them, I need to identify artists maybe before they have that song.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly. And that's what you're getting at. And it's a good point to make, because that was one of the big learning curves. I was like, oh, okay. I don't have 100,000. I can't just tell my DJ, go play this, see what happens.
Sure.
I'm like, I still had radio friends that would help me out with things like that, but it wasn't the same. And it was a lot more, I think this is a hit, mate. And convincing your employer to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to see.
Sure.
If it's a hit, it was a different story.
The risk is significantly higher. You can't just try it and if it doesn't work.
True.
Yeah. So, well, especially back then too, with, I'm sure the cost of making records was astronomically higher.
100%.
So can you talk about the process of when you got put in that position? Okay, well, I got to go find some bands. What did you do? Like, where did you start with that?
One of the other learning curves that I had, I thought, well, hey, I'm a big wig A&R guy for Atlantic Records now, and I'm just going to, you know, whisper out the window that I'm here and the bands will come flocking and I'll just be a magnet for, because all bands want to be signed by a major label. These are all naive things that were in my head. And then I realized that you've got to get out there and you've got to really work it and become known. And yes, tons of, you know, on my initial hiring, there was lots of like, oh, you know, there's an A&R guy in Orlando. Like that word did spread, but
sure,
you had to really work to spread that story. That meant going to conferences and showing up and going out at night and making sure you're meeting club owners and bookers and all these different people that touch bands as they come through town and book bands. So it was a lot more work than I initially thought.
Yeah.
Because again, I was a program director at a radio station and the records would just show up because it was such a powerful medium.
Yeah.
I didn't have to go find them.
It was a magnet.
It was a magnet. They came. Yeah. And so a major label is a magnet, but if you're an outlier A&R guy in a remote office down in Orlando, Florida, you still have to carry a big bright torch and make sure that you don't miss anything.
Yeah. So you were down in Florida and I imagine eventually, you said that first project you signed didn't really work, but then something clicked and something worked. What was the project where you signed and the record came out?
Hold that question it's directly related to what you just said. We'll get the Mighty Joe Plum, which is the record that didn't work. And it's true. The album didn't sell. The song ended up being a top five rock song.
Sure.
It just didn't sell. Like radio played it and it didn't sell like the other stuff did. So it fell short there. An interesting caveat to that story about Mighty Joe Plum, my first signing to Atlantic.
Yeah.
The drummer of that band, great drummer named Mark Mercado, who was this, it's always the drummer in these bands they have like the organizational skills. It seems like they're always the one in the band.
Well,
that's
if they can hit
the
that many things at the same time,
right.
It's like,
maybe there's a direct correlation.
There's a correlation there.
Banging stuff around and, you know, knowing how to make a flyer and organize things.
Yeah.
He was that guy. And he went on to become the manager of Paramore, one of the biggest bands I worked with. So I'm proud of helping him along that, but he was always going to be that. So it's ironic that the drummer, the first band I ever signed to Atlantic, is now the manager of one of the biggest bands that I work with.
Yeah. So Paramore, was that just, you know, for our audience who maybe doesn't realize, was Paramore kind of the first thing that was on the map with you in this role that was like, this is going to work, or were there steps in between your hiring and them?
Well, yeah, listen, man, I have a lot of misses, which we don't need to go into,
sure,
in this podcast. Or let's just talk about the things that work.
So we'll talk about the things that work. Exactly.
But no, but it's an interesting thing to bring up too, because I work for great people. Atlantic, yeah, is a great label, and I've had lots of great mentors and leaders and managers, that understand that A&R is, you're going to fail most of the time.
Yeah.
And so I'm not shooting for failure, but as long as you have somebody above you that recognizes that, it's like, you're definitely going to fail.
Yeah.
There's no doubt in this job, you are going to fail, and you might as well get used to it. If you can, it's batting average, right? You can do whatever sports analogy you want to use. You're going to, most things that you pick for one reason or another won't work. So, I forgot where I was going with that.
No. Yeah. And so obviously Paramore is something that worked really well. So
you asked if that was first.
Yeah.
So it's interesting the way that it works, but so Mighty Joe Plum, and then there's a band out of Birmingham. They were called Virgos Merlot. Mm. Signed them. That didn't work at all. Drummer from that band, and hopefully listeners will follow along with this, because I'm trying to illustrate how the industry works and how it's such not an exact science.
Yeah.
But the drummer from my second signing to Atlantic was dating this girl from Knoxville, Tennessee, and I was in the studio with Virgos Merlot, and his girlfriend happened to be there, and she came up to me and handed me a CD and said, I'm from Knoxville. This is my favorite band. This guy's voice is amazing. You should check it out. Hmm. And the name of the band was Dreve, D-R-E-V-E. Okay. And whatever, people handed me CDs all the time.
Sure.
I was like, great, I'll check it out. And sat on my desk for a while, finally pulled it out, and then there was this voice, and that ended up being Brent Smith from Shinedown. He was in a band called Dreve out of Knoxville, and it just lit me up.
Yeah.
And I was like, because that's what was, I just love that kind of voice, and it's kind of timeless. I don't care if it's Robert Plant or Chris Cornell.
Sure.
In rock music, that big.
It's a texture too.
Texture, grit, blues, soul, gospel, rock. That's just something that worked and something that spoke to me. And this band, Dreve, had a singer in it that he was like 22 years old. And anyway, we could do a whole separate podcast on Shinedown and how that happens. So I don't want to spend all this time on one thing, but it ended up, I went to Knoxville, and with the help of the great producer, Michael Beinhorn, who was a consultant with Atlantic at the time, I had turned him on to this band, and he's like, let's go see him. So we went and saw him, and, truth be known, and no offense to the band if they ever hear this podcast, but the band was not that great, but the singer was amazing. Mm. So long story short, I ended up signing Brent Smith to a solo deal at Atlantic, knowing full well that it had to be a band. Like, you couldn't just be
like a rock solo.
Right. Artist. It couldn't be Brent Smith.
Yeah.
Which isn't even that great of a name anyway.
Right.
Like, I was like, I believe in you so much, and I've got my boss, Craig Kalman, who also believes in you. I'll help you. I want to put you on a songwriting tour, help you learn how to write better songs, help you find your band. That's what a major label, like, that's the beautiful part of having a budget to pull a kid out of Knoxville, Tennessee, and just say, I believe in you, and to help guide them.
Yeah.
It's his vision. I didn't do it. I just rode shotgun and scheduled things and helped things. And then he's the one that said, I think it's called Shinedown. Mm. You know what I mean? I think,
wow.
And I had moved him to Jacksonville, Tennessee, which is where Limp Bizkit was, and Cold was coming out of there. Never mind Lynyrd Skynyrd from back in the day. And there was this rich history of rock music coming out of Knoxville. And so we started doing demos there, and that's where we found the band. And so that's the very brief story of how Shinedown became my first success as an A&R person at Atlantic.
So many successful releases later with Shinedown, there's Paramore, all of these amazing projects have culminated into what's been a just amazing career at Atlantic and A&R. And a big part of that that I want to talk about is the move to Nashville and bringing rock, bringing pop and alternative to a city that largely has been country music and singer-songwriter and Christian music. Can you talk about maybe the why behind that? Like, why did that initially happen, and what have been some of the maybe struggles to overcome?
So I started at Atlantic in 1997 or 98, and that was almost the peak of the CD compact disc era of the music business, and the music business was just on fire with alternative rock. The boy band thing was massive, and the CD was a huge financial boon to the industry, as we know. And then until it wasn't. And then when it wasn't, it crashed hard. So the reason I answer your question that way is because I had already been going to Nashville. I had signed a band from Nashville, from Franklin, actually, Paramore. Mm. Once the peak had crested, and then Napster came, and then Napster came, like it was a monster.
At the time, I mean,
at the time it was like, what is that? And people are not going to buy CDs pretty soon. And then, which is what happened. So the reason that's relevant to my story in Nashville is that my buddy, my good friend, Tom Storms, who was my A&R colleague at Atlantic on the West Coast, he's who I originally signed Paramore with. And the industry was going through massive downsizing because of the crash of the CD and online distribution. And Atlantic was no different. And through just giant staff cutbacks, he ended up losing his gig. And then he called me shortly after and was like, and he and I had been coming to Nashville to obviously see Hayley Williams and Paramore and help them with their records and all that. And he called me up and said, man, I'm moving to Nashville. He goes, I think LA's, you know, done for right now. And I think there's a new thing happening in Nashville, which he and I had talked about before. I was like, whoa, that's amazing. So he did. And then he and I had a handful of other friends that were moving here. And I started hearing from boots on the ground, hey man, something really going on here. Like, there's people are moving here, rock people and pop people, because of the downsizing of the industry. New York and LA folks were like, I just need to reinvent myself. I'm going to go to Nashville. So that helped inform me, like, this weirdo A&R guy that was in Orlando, Florida. I was like, well, I still don't want to move to New York. I love California. But I'm trying to raise my kids and I'm trying to have a good lifestyle, and we know how expensive it is in LA. So over time, it made more and more sense for me to, at this stage of my career, to get out of Florida. That was done. Like, for a brief while, it made sense for me to be there. There was so much music coming out of there. I was in Orlando, which was, again, the boy band. Like, that's where that was all made. It had nothing to do with it, but it was sort of a center of gravity of industry in Orlando that made it make sense. And then all that went away. I was like, I gotta get out of here. And so ultimately it became Nashville for the reasons I just talked about. I had lots of friends coming here and they were like, it's still driven by country music and Christian music, which we had known for a long time, but there's a new thing happening and I wanted to be a part of that.
Well, I love it. And you absolutely have been. Can you talk maybe a little bit about, any of the hurdles and difficulties into maybe expanding that? Or maybe the better way to ask is, are you sort of just following something that's organically happening? And you're like, I want to be a part of that, whether it's in Nashville, whether it's in Orlando.
I think as an A&R guy, that's what you do. You look for trends and try to be a part of those trends that make sense for your musical taste. And as time was going on, I started like Casey Musk, like there, I'm like, oh, I'm not a country guy, but there was a significant sliver of country and Americana that was, I was loving. And Casey Musgrave's first record was something that really I just fell in love with. And over time, my ear started to perk up for Jason Isbell. And I was like, this is all, and lots of stuff that Dave Cobb was doing started to become more and more a part of my personal taste. And I was like, well, that's all in Nashville. And it seems to be a trend, never mind the fact that I just dig that music.
Yeah.
So that was another part of it. Like it's interesting working for a major label and being paid for your taste in music and your gut reaction to it.
Yeah.
Is, you know, for most people, I listen to records when I go home, but the fact that my career and my life path is driven by me acknowledging that, oh, I really like this type of music and it's happening over there, I should go over there.
Yeah.
A big part of the drive to get
That's here. Awesome. Well, you've clearly had a very successful radar. And yeah, as you mentioned before, nobody's gets everything right 100% of the time. I mean, the fact that, you know, I can relate as a songwriter, the fact that we can walk in and if we had 29 out of 30 days in the month where, like, if only one out of 30 was a hit, that would be a wildly successful month.
Yeah. That's the business we're in.
Yeah, for us as songwriters.
Especially now, there's so much. It's redundant to say it, but I we have curators and Spotify has amazing people that do playlists and Apple Music, and there's people in place to sort it for you.
Yeah.
But it's still a lot.
It's a ton.
It's a ton of music, and it's a good thing, and it's also, you know, not too long ago when we started this interview and when I started my career in the 90s and before that, there was one big fat pipe that labels would push their music through. It was called radio.
Yeah.
And then the only way that people had to find out about it was to listen to the radio. So I'm not saying that was a better time necessarily, but it was certainly easier for the labels to prioritize and get music out there and expose it through the radio and then put it in a store, which clearly that's blown completely out of the water now.
Sure.
So, but it was also easier for consumers because they could really, because radio was the only outlet, they could really, a song that maybe they didn't even like at first would be on their favorite radio station every day for months. And then it would finally just become a part of their soundtrack of their life.
It's familiarity.
Yeah. Right. Familiarity would sink in and then maybe they'd buy the record or maybe they'd buy the ticket to the show. And now it's this, you know, I'm on Spotify every day and Apple Music and sometimes I play the role of consumer. I'm like,
how do you filter
new music Friday? There's hundreds of new songs every week.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, it is amazing, but it's difficult.
Overwhelming.
As we're kind of rounding out, we're going to dive into our lightning round. But as a deep dive, I'd love to know, as I'm sure a ton of our listeners would love to know, nowadays, what do you look for in an artist that makes them signable? Specific skills, metrics? Obviously, you know, radio, maybe still part of the live show. So we'll dive into some of those specifics in our deep dive. If people want to get access to that, just go to madeitinmusic.com, go to the show notes page. If you're cool to dive into some of that.
Is the deep dive, is that like...
We're going to do that
like
right after.
Like Bill Maher has his show on HBO and then they say after...
The exclusive content.
After, yeah.
Yes,
okay. That's
exactly.
What the deep dive is. Okay.
That's what we're going to do. So if people want to check out that, go to madeitinmusic.com. But let's dive into the lightning round if you're ready. First concert you ever went to?
First concert was, I actually wrote.
You came so prepared. I love this.
Sort of. I know. I don't even need notes for any of this stuff. I was just thinking about it earlier.
Yeah.
Steve Martin, I grew up in the 70s, partially in the 70s, and Steve Martin was a massive rock star and was a huge idol for me. And I bought all of his albums, and he came to Fort Wayne, Indiana, to play the Coliseum there. And so technically that was my first concert. Cause that was the first ticket that my parents bought for me. And it was a big celebrity, like a huge cultural thing coming to Fort Wayne So, and he did King Tut and all the, it was just, I still love Steve Martin. He's one of my heroes. But aside from that, in high school down in Florida, I was in Florida at the time, and Jethro Tull.
Okay.
Was my, at the Hollywood Sportatorium right outside Fort Lauderdale.
That's good. That's one of the Aqualungs, one of the songs my dad introduced me to when I was growing up.
Good taste.
Yeah. So that was good. And the Steve Martin book is on my reading list. I haven't read it yet.
Oh, Born Standing Up? It's awesome.
Amazing.
Yeah. So, if you would have to be a fan in some degree to really, but yeah. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Top trait in successful artists that you work with?
Top trait in successful artists that I work with.
Or that you have worked
with. Oh, it's easy and obvious. I'm actually trying to search for an alternate answer, but it's the voice. Mm. It's always the voice. And people are always like, what are you looking for? Like, oh, you're an A&R. What are you looking for? Great voice, singing great songs. Mm. I don't care if it's rock or pop or country or whatever. It's the voice.
Yeah.
So, and they don't even have to technically be a great singer. Which both Hayley Williams and Brent Smith both are have amazing range, and they are just phenomenally great singers. But I'm trying to think of an example. Sometimes just the tone. Like, I don't even know. I didn't sign Kacey Musgraves, but I'm a huge fan.
Yeah.
And I listen to her records, and I think if you're really picking it apart, she's not like some amazing. She's not Adele.
There's no vocal acrobatics happening.
That's right. But just the her head, just the tone and the way it comes out of her head and out of her mouth and out of her chest, like it's fascinating to me.
Yeah.
The sound of the human voice, which is maybe why I got in radio in the first place, and maybe I like doing voiceover. I'm always, I think people in general are. I'm not special about it, but I'm very aware of how drawn to the human voice I am.
Yeah.
Whether it's a voiceover guy on TV, I'll be like, oh, that's that actor.
Yeah.
I recognize that voice, or it's certainly singing voice, which is.
Yeah,
is the thing. So
that's a great answer. One that a lot of people probably skip over because.
That's to me it's very basic.
Yeah, that's awesome. Top goal for this next year.
Did I write down my goals? Let me see if I wrote down my goals.
And it can be personal. It can be professional. It can be.
Oh! My top goal.
Yeah.
Is to I've got a lot of baby artists.
Okay.
That I've been developing.
Yeah.
And where's my list of baby artists? I actually wrote.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's good. If you got any inside scoops on some things that might be coming.
Well, so since I've been in Nashville, I've signed bands from here, as you might expect, because there's such a deep pool of talent. But I have this band, Betcha.
Yeah.
That I keep saying I signed them out of Belmont College. A couple of them went to Belmont, but they were sort of part of the whole Belmont scene. I have an amazing pop singer named Galaxara that, Galaxara. There's no music out yet.
Okay.
Maybe by the time this is up,
yeah,
there might be Galaxara music out there.
If there is, we'll link to it in the show notes.
Good. So, that'll be the start of it. That'll be the start of the fire. No, this girl, I've signed her at 15. Her name is Galaxara, and she is equal parts Freddie Mercury and Lady Gaga.
Oh, wow.
If I may be so bold.
Yeah, you may.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to hearing that and seeing that.
So Galaxara, I signed a band out of Virginia called Illiterate Light, who are a duo in the same vein as Black Keys. There's a drummer and a guitar player, and they don't sound like Black Keys at all, but it's that format, but they sound more like My Morning Jacket meets Flaming Lips and Cage the Elephant and those kind of bands. So that's Illiterate Light. That music is out now. So I'm very excited about that. Josie Dunn is another Nashville signing.
Yeah.
So she's already out there, and she just had a big feature with Matoma. And so Josie Dunn is something I'm very excited about. I signed another artist with Dave Cobb, actually, too. Oh, cool. We have a label with Dave Cobb, or a label deal with Dave Cobb. Yeah. He has a label called Low Country Sounds. Hmm. And I had found this Nashville artist out of Belmont College named Savannah Conley, who I turned Dave on to, and he loved it. So we signed her, and we're making her record right now. And so there's another band called Wilder Woods that I think is going to blow a lot of people's minds.
Yeah,
that'll be coming out soon.
So the goal being just get the baby bands.
Those are what other goal could I have? Like, professional goal. That's all I live for,
get
is to break artists or get them to the next level. And so those are some of the ones that,
yeah, it's a great, that, great goal.
I'm excited about.
That's awesome. First job you ever had?
First job was a bag boy at Publix in Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
All right.
Not a, an amazing story.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. It was the launching pad
yeah.
for not training me for any part of this.
Yeah. I love it. And lastly, is there anyone in music that you've wanted to meet or work with that you haven't yet?
Yeah, you know,
it could be artists, could be professional, it could be anybody.
It could be anybody, and I've met a lot of the great ones. I have this weird fantasy of meeting Eddie Vedder.
Okay.
Because I being in radio and doing this, I've met lots of famous people, musicians mainly, and I don't know. I'm just such a huge Pearl Jam fan. I admire.
So he never came through the studio.
He no, there. they were so massive that. They were so like any of like, oh, they're coming through Orlando. Why don't you come by? That lots of other artists did, lots of big artists.
Yeah.
But the Pearl Jam just didn't function that way.
Well, let's make sure to tag Eddie Vedder on social media. You never know. You put it out there.
Yeah. 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 He's interesting. I won't go on long about Eddie Vedder. Yeah. I know that's not why we're here.
Yeah.
But just being in the industry and loving Pearl Jam since the first moment I heard it. And then reading interviews with him where he would talk about the records that influenced him, and they're the same records that influenced me, and he's a great artist and I'm not, but I feel like I have some, like The Who, Quadrophenia was one of his big albums, huge album for me when I was in high school, and the things that he would name check, it's interesting to make that correlation because Pearl Jam's music makes me feel the same way as the records that he grew up on.
Those influences.
It's interesting how that works. It's almost an identical feeling.
Yeah.
When I listen to Pearl Jam as I do to The Who and some of those early albums.
Man, it kind of reminds me as we're closing out of that great quote, I think it's Isaac Newton or something. If I see further than anybody else, it's because I'm standing on the shoulders of giants.
There you go.
And that's so much what everything we work on nowadays is.
Yes. You can't
influence.
Be whether you're an artist or an A&R person that's had whatever level of success, you can't, I did this all by myself.
Yeah.
It's no way to live your life, no matter what you do.
Yeah, exactly.
Humility, being humble, and that's a great quote.
Yeah.
That is a great way to sort of round things out.
Yeah. Well, Steve Robertson, Atlantic Records, thank you so much for being on the Made It Music podcast with us.
You're welcome, Seth.
And for our audience who really wants to deep dive into what do you look for that makes an artist signable, you touched a little bit on it, but we'll spend 3 or 4 minutes talking about that. In the post interview, they can find the show notes for the show at madeitmusic.com. So thanks again, Steve.
Thank you, Seth. Later.
Hey, what's up? Thanks for hanging out on this YouTube video with us. In case you didn't know, this is from the Made It Music Podcast Season 2. We have a ton of awesome guests that come on the show, all music business professionals, to share their knowledge and experience with you. So if you want to subscribe to not miss any future episodes, hit that subscribe button on YouTube and you'll be notified about all of them. And in case you didn't know, we do a deep dive for every episode where we go really in depth on a certain topic from each podcast episode. So sign up right here to get free unlimited access to all of those deep dives from our podcast. And if you want to watch another Made It in Music podcast video, click here.